This is the Thoughtful Travel Podcast. I'm your host, Amanda Kendall of the notaballerina.com travel blog. Every episode, I'll share travel tales from several fellow travel lovers, and together we hope to entertain and inspire you, remind you of some of your own great travel experiences, and encourage you to hit the road again soon. Hello and welcome to episode 116 of the Thoughtful Travel Podcast. Today we've got a fun topic. It's about choosing your next destination. Now I know that for many of you, and myself included, planning your next trip is almost as fun as actually being on your next trip. And I do love that the fun and the thrill of figuring out where it is you're going to be able to go next. So I've actually got four guests today instead of my usual two or three, just because I had four people who each had something different but equally interesting to say about how they choose their next destination. And I couldn't pick which one to leave out. So I thought, hang on, it's my podcast. I'll include all four of them. So I'll have four guests for you later on in the podcast. Before we get to that, I want to quickly mention the sponsor of this episode of the Thoughtful Travel Podcast, which is my very own travel journal school. So coming up in January, that's January 2019, if you're listening to this in the future, I've got the Travel Journal School journal writing course coming out again. It hasn't run for quite a long time, and it's got a, it's going to have had a big rewrite by then. It's one of the most fun things that I enjoy teaching online. So it's going to be a 3-week course, all about writing a journal or a travel diary that is not boring. Because if you're anything like me, it's all too easy to sit down at the end of a day and say, I went to this place and I saw this and I ate this at this hotel, blah, 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 and you never want to read it again. So if you're curious about that, you can sign up to get an email as soon as that course is out. And you can sign up at notaballerina.com/journal. And I'll leave a link in the show notes, of course, as well. So on to the topic of choosing your next destination. And this is particularly relevant for me right now because as of this moment in time, I actually have zero flights booked to anywhere in the coming year. And that is a very unusual situation for me. I do have some ideas and some probable destinations, but no flights booked. And I've got one particular trip that I keep thinking about because I'm not sure what else to do with it. So my son and I have been invited to his cousin's wedding, which will be on Krabi in Thailand. So we'll be in Thailand in the middle of next year, but I'm trying to decide where else to go. You know, once we've got all the way to Thailand, it's not super far from Perth, but still, you know, the bulk of the cost is getting there. And then we're kind of, you know, in the middle of Southeast Asia, where else will we go? We might as well enjoy somewhere else. Will we return to somewhere like Phnom Penh, where we were already this year and loved? Will I take my son to enjoy Bangkok, where he's never been, and where I've only been for two work trips where I haven't had that many chances to get out and about and see a lot of Bangkok, and the little bit I've seen, I've enjoyed? Or will we go somewhere more rural, somewhere quiet, somewhere beachy, somewhere completely new? I really can't decide. I keep staring at the map and I've looked at flights, you know, directly from Krabi. Where else do they go? What's going to be easy to get to? And there's just so many possibilities, I can't decide. So if you have a great idea for me, please get in touch. Maybe one of you will have the idea that finally says to me, ah, yeah, that's the one I want to do. So, yeah, it's always a fun thing to do, choosing your next destination. And let's get on to our guests who've discussed this exact topic. And my first guest today is Tamara Gruber, who travels sometimes with just her daughter, sometimes with the family, with her husband as well, and has a kind of a different method for choosing destinations, depending on exactly who she's traveling with.
We have different types of trips that we do. Right. So in the summer, my daughter and I do like a mother-daughter road trip. So therefore, we're U.S. focused. And I'm also on this quest to visit all 50 states by the time I turn 50. So we're kind of checking off some of those. But we've still, I mean, we're now getting towards the end, so it's kind of like, okay, next year has to be Idaho, you know, but like last year we had some choices, and, you know, one of them was to drive through a lot of the southern states in the U.S. And so my daughter just finished studying about the civil rights movement. And so we decided to make it a civil rights themed road trip through through the South. And so, you know, sometimes there's something like that that might guide it. But really, I left it up to her last year. We said, OK, here are the couple of options. Which would you rather do? And that's what she picked, because it sounded like, you know, something she was interested in learning more about. And that drove what we did in those destinations as well. I mean, we still added in some food tours and, you know, some other things, but we really made that the focus of our trip. So there's, you know, that kind of trip. And then we do a family trip, and the family trip is usually somewhere where we really want to explore. So we tend to go to Europe a lot because, you know, for us, the flights aren't too bad. It's fairly easy for us to do in a shorter period of time because, you know, being an American, we don't get a lot of vacation time. So we, you know, we have to deal with those kind of constraints. You know, right now we are saving up like, okay, maybe every few years we can take a longer trip. And so we are focused on doing something in South America for next year. So, you know, a lot of it is really dictated by our schedule, our budget. Sometimes things just pop up. Like a couple of years ago, there was an airfare sale and we got a great deal to fly to somewhere in like Central Europe. And we were trying to, you know, think about like it hadn't been somewhere that it was somewhere that we wanted to go, but it wasn't like definitely where we were going next. But it just, you know, we had this great airfare and we're like, okay, we've always wanted to go to Vienna. Let's go to Vienna. And then what can we add on to that? Well, we can take the train to Budapest. And so that's what we did. So that was really dictated by a good airfare that we found. So we kind of have a lot of different ways of picking our next destination, but it usually involves some kind of voting, you know, within the family of like, okay, here are three choices. What are your, you know, or here are five choices. What are your top two? What are your top two? What are your top two? Where does that overlap? And then trying to figure out, okay, now let's look at budget and, you know, other factors and see if that helps us narrow it down.
So it's quite a democratic decision-making process. That's good.
Is, yeah.
But I think you're right. I have quite often taken trips purely because of the airfare deal that I come across. And it's very dangerous. I'm often seeing good airfare deals and I'll yell out to my son, shall we go to, you know, to, oh, look, there's a new great deal to Tokyo. Shall we go to Tokyo next holidays? He's like, we already went to Japan this year. I'm like, oh, yeah. Okay, maybe next year. And I'm a bit obsessed with good airfare deals, and I don't have the time nor the money to take them all. But
and I was going to say, and we just don't find many good airfare deals here. So for us, it's like a rarity. And usually it is, like I said, it is more to go to Europe than anywhere else. It's and many times we end up doing that because it's actually cheaper for us to fly to Europe from here on the East Coast than for us to fly to like California or, you know,
wow,
so it's
really,
it can be crazy. Yeah. Sometimes it's actually, you know, more expensive to go to Florida, like if it's at like spring break time, or it's just airfares in the U.S. are high. It's really hard to find some good deals. And if it is, it's to go to a city that I can drive to or a city that I am not interested in, you know, so not a lot of great deals.
Yeah. I mean, similarly here, it's actually much cheaper for us from Western Australia to fly to Southeast Asia than it is to fly to anywhere else in Australia. So my son's seen much more of Asia than he has of his own country, simply it's just so much cheaper. And some of it's quite a lot closer as well, because Australia's so vast with nothing in the middle. So, you know, there's not many options. I'd love to be a fly on the wall at these family discussions when they're all kind of voting for which destination they're going to get to. I wonder, Tamara, are there any arguments that take place, or is it a fairly peaceful process? I'm curious. Anyway, my next guest is Meagan Hurst, who has actually a similar strategy to one I often use in trying to decide where she's going to travel to next.
I honestly choose the next destination based on my budget and where I can find a cheap flight. So Especially when I was studying abroad in Europe, we would just use like Ryanair or the super cheap low cost airlines and be like, literally, what's the easiest and cheapest one? And so that's kind of how I explored Europe. And lately I've been using, or I've been subscribed to a thing called Scott's Cheap Flights, and he sends out emails. I'm not sure if it's in Australia, but for the States, it's really helpful. And he'll send out a cheap flight and I'll be like, oh, I'm looking to go somewhere around that time of year, or I've had this destination in mind. And then that kind of like gives me the motivation, or because it's like he predicts a deal will only last for 48 hours. It kind of gets me like motivated and gives me that like urgency to just book a flight and do it. So that's how I booked the Southeast Asia flight. The past two times I went to Southeast Asia, I got those tickets for each. One was like 320 return from California to Singapore. And the other one was 550 round trip. So, yeah, honestly, because I'm not a big, like, I don't have a big budget when I travel, it's just kind of where can I get the cheap flight. And then I guess my second part, or my second answer to that question, kind of two parts, is where other people are traveling. So, like, for instance, we had the Hands-On Journeys tour. So it was kind of like, a good reason to go on it. So I guess I don't really like strictly plan my destinations. It's just kind of how it fits in with budgeting and with like what other people are doing and what tours I can join or what my other travel partners are interested in going.
Yeah, I think that's an awesome way to pick it. I actually haven't checked if Scott's Cheap Flights is works in Australia, but I know the one that I'm on the list of is called I Know the Pilot. And I get these emails that are so tempting, like they keep offering the last few weeks. There's all these amazing deals for next European summer, and like really good airlines for like $800 return. And I think, oh my gosh, let's just go. And but then I think, hang on, I've actually kind of got trips booked at that time, and Europe's a really long way, and you can't just go for 5 minutes. But yeah, it's very tempting. So often I'll say, oh, let's just buy this flight. But
I saw just today, round trip from LA to Nairobi, Kenya, for 600 return. And that's like a super rare flight deal. And I was like, oh my God. And that's someplace I do want to go that's been on my radar. I think now that I've traveled quite a bit, it's kind of also narrows down to like, where haven't I been for deciding my next destinations? And so Africa and South America are kind of higher on my priority list now, I guess, because those are places I haven't been.
Yep. Me too. I need to see more of those areas. So it's definitely something that's coming up for me as well, I think. Yeah. It's hard though. So many destinations and so little time and not enough money. I love that Meagan can be easily persuaded by her Scott's Cheap Flights emails to decide on a next destination. I am very similar with my I Know the Pilot emails that work pretty well for Australia. Very, very tempting. And I've been definitely used those cheap flights to decide where we're going to go next. Now, my next guest today is Cham. You might remember Cham as my fabulous Cambodian buddy who guided us during our Cambodian trip from a couple of episodes ago. And he's given a lot of thought to how he decides where he's going to go next.
So it used to be difficult for me, like, when should I travel next? Where should I go? And why do I have to go there? So when it comes to asking me, like, how do I choose my next destination? It's going to be my real purpose of going that place. So the first question, number one, is why I'm going there. The second, number one, what I'm going to see over there. And the last one, how I'm going to benefit from there.
I like it.
So, yeah. So to me, traveling in some other new area or new country, it's not just for traveling. I want at the same time to see the city and gain something back. So be like, I know there's a pro and con and everything, but at the same time, I want to spend money and get better experience that I cannot find anywhere else. And to choose the next destination for me is for me to unlock more potential inside of me. Like, what can that place can offer me? Maybe a leadership skill, speaking skill, or a team bonding skill. That way I would love to go. And of course, there's something that would attract your mind for you to go there, right? For example, in June or July, I went to Indonesia to join your program. Not just joining the program itself, of course, I'm interested in the program, but at the same time, I was able to climb the volcano, which is called Bromo Mountain. It was the first volcano climbing in my entire life that I never experienced it before. And that was the reason that I decided to go to that country. That's how come I, it's the way that I choose my destination.
I really like that. It's a combination. There's like a purpose, kind of a bigger purpose than just travel, but also finding something that's a new experience like volcano climbing.
Yeah, correct. And on top of that as well, when I look into all the itinerary and also to see the country, what it can have to offer, I like to involve myself in the society. Because a lot of people are just struggling to see the sizing area, but to me, I would like want to involve into people as well.
Oh, I totally agree. Because these days, there's so much on the internet. There's videos and pictures of all of the sites. You can kind of almost see them just from the comfort of your own home. So there has to be more reason than just that, I think.
Yes. And then what's touched me the most is people of every country, religion, and their way of life. That always bring me to another level of perspective that we're all human beings. We live in the same world, just different country. And then I came to realize that even though we are different in terms of nation, race, religion, or country, we ourselves does not have to be different. It's just traveling makes us different, but we are still the same.
I agree, absolutely. The more I travel, the more I think that we are all exactly the same. Because we're all human beings, so we have so much in common. And these things that are different, whether it's our different language or different appearance or different cultural habits, they're so minor and insignificant compared to the fact that we are really, really just the same. So,
yes.
Yeah, I agree.
You're right.
Yeah. Cham is definitely one of my most thoughtful traveler friends, and I'm not surprised he has lots of really good reasons to choose various destinations. So, good stuff. Now, my final guest today is Greg Seymour, and he is currently living a good life, I reckon. Left corporate America to travel or to do more longer term traveling, and that making those trips longer has changed a lot about how he decides what to do next and where to go.
In 2013, my wife and I basically kind of had enough of the earn more, spend more grind of the American dream. And so we quit corporate America, sold everything except really 9 suitcases worth of stuff, and flew to Costa Rica, where we lived for 4 years. Mm. And so that kind of set up how we adventure moving forward. We typically take our travels typically take more of a long form. So it's not just a week in one place. It's usually years or months, or last year it was the Appalachian Trail, which we spent 6 months hiking. And you know, part of the way we choose what we're going to do is we want something that is outside our comfortable comfort zone, but not too uncomfortable. We're not going to blaze a new trail up a mountain, but we'll do something that's challenging to us physically or culturally, and follow where other people may have blazed before.
That's a really sensible attitude, because it's really important, I think, to do something outside your comfort zone. But sometimes people think that means it must be something way outside your comfort zone, but that often means you just don't do it. Whereas choosing something that's just a step or two beyond your comfort zone makes it much more achievable, and then you do it.
Absolutely. And you know, Costa Rica was a really good segue into that. It allowed us to transition out of kind of a posh lifestyle in Dallas, Texas, into kind of a developing country where we lived much more simply, just because that's what we were choosing to do. And that then transitioned to hiking the Appalachian Trail, which was much more basic, where you're carrying your basics on your back, your food, your water, your shelter. and you're doing it for, you know, living out in the woods for 6 months at a time.
Yeah, 6 months is a pretty long hiking trip, I reckon.
Yeah, it was. But you know, once again, it was uncomfortable, but uncomfortable enough, or comfortable enough, I guess. The Appalachian Trail is very well traveled now. 10 years ago, it wasn't so much, but with Bill Bryson's book, A Walk in the Woods, and with Cheryl Strayed's book, Wild, even though it's on the west coast of the U.S., it really popularized long distance hiking, even though both those authors never really completed their journey. So you're finding on the Appalachian Trail that you're hitting a trail town that is welcoming to hikers, you know, every 4 or 5 days. So it's, you know, you're out in the wilderness for 3 or 4 days, but then you get a shower and you get to resupply. So like I said, in the beginning, it's just uncomfortable enough and exciting enough. But it's not super crazy, at least in our opinion.
It's not crazy enough that it makes you want to give up halfway through. So
It was very difficult. And I wouldn't say we wanted to give up, but you know, every single day on the trail was very challenging.
Right. Yes. I don't want to make it sound like it's easy. That's for sure. So what's your next, destination or your next trip?
In September. Yeah. Okay. In September, we're heading to Spain, to walk the Camino de Santiago, the French way, which starts at the border of France and Spain, in the Pyrenees Mountains. It'll take about 500 miles, and it'll take us, well, we have a month and a half, 45 days scheduled for it, but the actual walk will take us probably 35 days or so. Then we're going to spend some time on the front end in France and then on the back end in Madrid. And then we chose that, you know, for the same reasons that I mentioned earlier. You know, it's stretching us culturally this time. We have the hiking chops to do the walking because it's much more mild than walking up and down mountains on the east coast of the U.S. But we'll get involved in speaking the language and eating new foods and you know, experiencing Spain. Neither my wife nor I have been to Spain yet.
Oh, fabulous. I have been to Spain, but I have not done a walk on the Camino yet, though I really want to someday. But I'm sure you will love it. And like you say, yeah, the physical part will be a piece of cake after your 6 month stint, but the cultural stuff will be fascinating. That's a great plan.
Yep. And, you know, it's a good follow-up to the Appalachian Trail, which was so grueling from a physical standpoint that we wanted to pick something that was still a challenge, but you know, a little more culturally and historically interesting.
Oh, I think it'll be a great trip. I think that's an excellent decision. A good choice. Well done. So after all those different explanations and possibilities, how do you decide where you're going next? How do you choose your next destination? I would love it if you could come over to our Facebook group. It's called Thoughtful Travelers. You can just search for Thoughtful Travelers in Facebook or click through the link in the show notes and request to join and come and tell me how you choose your next destination. This is just five, including me, possibilities. I bet there are still more ways. And it's, I don't know, it's just an interesting idea to think about. How do we get where we end up? It's so many good thoughts and just a lot of fun to daydream about where you're going to go next, isn't it? As I mentioned, the show notes, you'll find them at notaballerina.com/116. And all of these important links are there. First of all, the sponsor for this episode was Travel Journal School. And you can sign up at notaballerina.com/journal to find out more about the journal writing course I'm running in January. It will go on sale soon because, scarily enough, January is not that far away. I chatted first today with Tamara from Vacation Mavens. You can find her at vacationmavens.com. And she's also part of the we3travel.com blog.
I then talked with Meagan Hurst. Meagan's from Marlas with a Mission, and you can find her at marlaswithamission.com or on Instagram at marlaswithamission. Then I chatted with Cham, and his Facebook page is linked in the show notes, and it's also if you look under facebook.com/communitybasedtourismtraveller. And last but definitely not least, I chatted with Greg, and Greg is Greg Seymour on the podcast for the first time today, and you can find him at AppalachianTrailTales.com. He also has a book on Amazon called Through Hiking, the Appalachian Trail, 100 Tips, Tricks, Traps and Facts. So definitely worth looking up if you are heading towards the Appalachian Trail. Somewhere I will get to someday, I'm sure. Other than that, just to repeat, you can find all of this information in the show notes at notaballerina.com/116, and come and chat with me about where you're headed next and why, and anything else Thoughtful Travel, in the Facebook group for Thoughtful Travellers. Thank you so very much for listening. This has been another episode of the Thoughtful Travel Podcast. Show notes and other information are at notaballerina.com/podcast. Join me again soon for another chat about why we travel. Bye for now.